Today we will talk about how to test an IPM, Intelligent Power Module. I will explain four methods to do this, so let's get started, and I will give you a complete demonstration of how to test them. As you can see, I have many IPMs and PCBs on the table, including outdoor PCBs from various brands like O-General, Orient, and Sharp, and I have IPMs from almost all brands. Some of these are faulty, while others are in good condition, so you can easily check them. I will show you how to do that. The first method is a physical test, which involves physically checking an IPM to see if it is faulty or functional. So first of all, I have an IPM here. When we look at it physically, the back seems fine, but the front is severely damaged. It looks like it has exploded. For example, if it looks like this, it's easy to tell that the IPM is faulty. Now here's another IPM of the same type. When you look at it, there doesn't appear to be any physical damage, but when you touch the copper part of the IPM, you can feel that it is slightly raised. This means it has been damaged, swollen, and is faulty. You can easily assess this. Next, I have another IPM for the physical test. At first glance, it looks original and new, but that's not the case. It has exploded and is damaged. You can see that it has been blasted from underneath. The way an IPM is designed, it has a heatsink attached to the top, so it can be challenging for anyone to judge if the IPM is physically faulty or not. So this type of situation can arise. So, that concludes the physical test. Now, in the same way, I will show you how to perform the second test, so let's move on to its demonstration. Here, you can see all the IPMs laid out, and I will show you how to identify which ones are faulty and which ones are functioning correctly. This will be the multimeter test, our second test. We'll start the test without the PCB. Once you've removed the IPM from the PCB, you can test it independently. If you've recently purchased a new IPM, you can also check if it is functional or faulty. As you can see, all these IPMs are on the table, and they all work on nearly the same principle. Although they are from different models and companies, they operate based on the same principle. Now, I'll explain a little bit of its diagram so that when you perform the test, you'll know exactly what we're doing. Now, let's look at any IPM. It has one high side and one low side. I'll draw a diagram to show you. The IPM has a shape like this. This side has multiple pins, which is the low side. I'm explaining this as an example. On the other side, there are 3 points, so I've drawn 3 points here, followed by another 3 points, and then 1 point. The first 3 pins represent negative points, and the last point is our positive. The remaining are W, V, and U. Now, we need to test them. Most of the testing should be focused on the high side, as there is a low probability of issues on the low side. Mainly the problems occur on the high side, so we'll focus on how to check the high side. This IPM is completely fine. Now, I will show you how to test it. You need to take your multimeter and set it to diode mode. When you switch it to diode mode, be careful not to make any mistakes while connecting the probes. Connect the black probe to the common terminal and insert the red probe into the volts and ohms meter input. First, you need to start from the negative side, where the U, V, W, and positive pins are separately attached to different negative pins. Specifically, when we check the IPM without the PCB, each negative pin will be tested individually with the U, V, W, and positive pins. Therefore, first, I place the negative probe on the negative point, which is the first point of the IPM, and then I connect the red probe to the positive point. You should not get any reading at this point. In the same way, I will connect the negative probe to the second point, and again, there should be no reading. The same applies to the third point. There should be no reading for any of the 3 points when checking with a positive pin. Similarly, when you check W, there should be no reading, and the same goes for V and U. Now change the polarity of the multimeter probes. You will connect the positive probe to any one of the negative points. If you connect it to the first point, remember that it is the first one. Then when you place the negative probe on the positive pin, you should see a reading. Here, the voltage drop on the multimeter is 0.813 volts, which is the reading you should expect. In this way, the second and third negative points should also have the same voltage drop reading. If there is no reading on any one of these points, it means it has become faulty. After that, you should move the negative probe to W, and there should be no reading here. Then move it to V, and again, there should be no reading. Now, when you move it to U, you should get a reading of 0.412, which means that our first IGBTs are perfectly fine and are working correctly with the negative point. In the same way, you need to test the second point with the negative point and positive probes, and test all points again. Here you should see 0.814 voltage drop. Then, on the second point, there should be no reading, and on the third point, you should get a reading of 0.412 volts. The second negative point is okay with the VIGBT. After that, you will go to the third position. When you connect the positive probe to the negative, you should see a reading of 0.813 volts. Next, move on the W pin. You should see 0.412 volts. The third negative point is okay with the WIGBT. When you move to the next point, you should not get any reading at all. If you do get a reading here, it means there is a short circuit. In this way, you can easily check the IPM and you can confirm that the IPM is perfectly fine at this time. And now, friends, after this, we will conduct the next test where I will show you how to identify faulty IPMs. Here I have two IPMs that are exactly the same, but one of them has an extra pin that is not connected. You can check the data sheets of the IPMs to understand their configurations. We will take this particular IPM since we performed the first test with similar IPMs. Now, as I told you, you should place the negative probe on the negative and the positive probe on the positive. So I placed the negative on the first point, and there should be no reading. Then I moved the negative to the second point, and again there should be no reading. When I checked the third point, there should still be no reading. When I placed the positive probe on the first point, I did not get any reading. The same goes for the second point. There is no reading. And now, at the third point, there should not have been any reading, but it shows 0.00. This means the IGBTs with the W pin is faulty. When we change the probes, connecting the positive to the negative and the negative to the positive, let's see what happens. Here it shows a value of 0.411, but it should have been around 0.8 something. It should not show anything at this point. Also, it should not show a reading here, yet it does show a value, but the first point shows a very low value. Now let's move to the second point, connecting the positive to the negative point. When we check it, it shows 0.812, no reading on the second pin. On the next pin, it shows 0.411, and here it shows a value of 0.812. This indicates that either the two IGBTs are shorted together at this point, or there is a leakage issue between them. Next, when we test the third negative pin with the positive pin, we observe a lower voltage drop, whereas it should generally appear on the W pin with a range of around 0.7 to 0.45. There should be no reading on the V pin, which is correct, but we're getting a voltage drop on the U pin. This indicates that the third negative point is shorted with the U pin. When testing the IPM on a PCB, it is essential to discharge the capacitors. If you don't discharge them, often the capacitors on the faulty PCB are fully charged and won't discharge on their own. Therefore, it's crucial to discharge them to avoid damaging yourself or the equipment. Let me show you how to discharge them. For this, you will need a soldering iron, and it's best if it has a light indicator. Here's what you need to do. Take both probes and connect them. You can connect them to the positive and negative terminals of the capacitor, or if there is a special place for connecting, you can use that as well. As you can see, once you attach them like this, if the light turns on and then slowly goes off, it means that the capacitor has fully discharged. The PCB is now fully discharged, and there is no issue remaining. This is how you can discharge it. Now let's discuss the third method for testing the IPM on the PCB. I will show you how to identify both the functional PCB and the faulty one. Let's take a look again at the diagram of the IPM. Here is our IPM as it is on the PCB. This part represents the low side, and since our high side is on this side, we will draw pins on the high side. As you can see, this is the positive terminal, this is W, this is V, and this is U. All three of these are negative point. Now, let me show you this on the PCB. Here, as you can see, all three negative points are connected in the PCB. We also connected these three points here. After this, we began the testing. Now, set the multimeter to diode mode and start the testing. First, connect the negative lead to the negative point and the positive lead to the positive point. After a short while, you will see the voltage fluctuating, and then it will stabilize. This means that at this point, there is some voltage present for a moment, and then it goes off, indicating that this point is indeed working correctly. Now, when we check point W, there should be no voltage present there. Similarly, when we check point V, there should be no voltage. And when we check point U, there should also be no voltage. This is in that position where the negative lead is connected to the negative point and the positive lead is connected to the positive point. Now we will switch the probes, connect the red probe to the negative point and the black probe to the positive point. As you can see, there is some voltage reading here at 0.485 volts. When this voltage appears, it indicates that the IPM is completely functioning from the positive side. Next, we will check point W, and it should also show around 0.412 volts. Then we check the next point, which should also show 0.412 volts. After that, the next point should also display 0.412 volts. This means that all these points are functioning properly. Since they are connected to each other, all the IGBTs are interconnected, and they will show the same voltage value across all points. This indicates that the IPM is functioning correctly from the high side, and there are no issues with it. Now, we will conduct the fourth test, and I will show you how to do it. When you supply electricity to the PCB, you need to know how to check it. As you can see, we have prepared the demonstration again, and the unit is ready. We will supply electricity, and I will show you how to check it to determine whether it is functioning correctly or faulty. Pay attention, you will hear the switching sound. Now you need to set the multimeter to DC volts. The PCB now has electricity, so proceed with caution. First, connect the positive probe to the positive point and the negative probe to the negative point. Here, you will find DC 303 volts, which means the electricity is functioning perfectly. Next, move the probe to point W, and you will see a reading of 11.70 volts, indicating that it is also functioning correctly. Now I will check on the V pin. You will also find a reading of 11.70 volts there. Finally, let's check point U, where you will find approximately 11.71 volts. In this O general model, we are getting around 11.7 volts on the U, V, and W points, but the voltage on these points can vary within a different range. Due to various designs and circuit layouts, the range I have experienced is typically between 10 volt DC and 15 volt DC. This means that when you get a reading of 320 volts on the positive and negative terminals, and around 15 volts on the U, V, and W points, it indicates that your IPM is completely functioning correctly. Now, let's explain how a faulty IPM behaves and how it appears. When checked without electricity, it seems fine, but once electricity is supplied, it turns out to be faulty. Let's demonstrate how it looks. As you know, for regular testing, set the multimeter to diode mode. When we tested it, the voltage rose momentarily and then dropped, showing no value on any point. I switched the probes and tested again. It showed a 0.410 voltage drop on the positive, 0.410 voltage drop on W, the same voltage drop on V, and the same at the U pin, too. This indicates that the IPM appears to be perfectly fine on all points without electricity, and there's no issue. Now, let's apply electricity and see what happens when it's powered up, as all the IGBTs short out with electricity and don't function properly. So, we applied power, and it started switching normally, appearing to work fine. Now, set the multimeter to DC volts and check by connecting the positive to the positive point and the negative to the negative point. When we check, it shows 304 volts. Next, let's check the second point, W, which shows approximately 11.56 volts. Now we will test on the V pin, and here we encounter an issue. It shows 304 volts instead of the expected voltages, even though it seemed fine in the initial testing. This indicates that the IPM is completely shorted on the V point, where electricity is directly flowing. Let's also check U, which shows 11.93 volts, which is correct. However, the V point is shorted, causing electricity to flow directly, which is why the IPM passed the initial testing, but shows a short circuit when powered. This means that the IPM is faulty and needs to be replaced. This is how you can perform all the tests on an IPM with on and off conditions on the PCB, with the details explained here. Click on the left or right thumbnail to watch our next videos and subscribe. Thank you.